Many entrepreneurs make the big blunder of overestimating themselves. I have started the company. I know everything. I have 360 degrees capability. I know finance. I know marketing. I know manufacturing. I know technology. I know HR. Impossible. God has not given us every possible capability.
Today, we have in our studio Mr. Robin Banerjee, who's written a fine book on who blunders and how, the dumb side of the corporate world. Welcome, Mr. Banerjee, to Bibliophile. Let me begin by asking you in a more generic sense. Most people don't look at failures. They are more concerned with successes in the corporate world, whether it's magazines or TV. You have written a book like this, but what do we learn from failures?
Failures are the stepping stone for success. Everything what we have learned in our life is from a failure. We learned to walk because in the first few steps, or maybe number of steps, we tumbled. We learned to ride a bicycle because we failed several times. Now, if you don't fail, we don't learn. Unfortunately, the corporate world does not talk about failures. Failures, mistakes, blunders are all shoved on the carpet, which means everything's hunky-dory, not possible. In any business decision, if you take 10 decisions, 7 perhaps goes wrong, 8 goes wrong, 2 perhaps succeeds. We always discuss and talk about the 2, but what about the balance 8? This book is all about that. So much great learning can happen from those 8 cases which could not succeed.
Your book has a big chapter on family businesses, where you said that family businesses generally, some of them over generations, they fail. Can you give for our viewers some examples on the international one? We'll come back to the Indian examples later, but on the international, where the big failures happen in the family business, not in the professionally run companies.
Most businesses are family businesses. Almost 80% of the businesses which we have encountered, including the mom and pop shops, the corner shops, these are all family companies. Most companies or most businesses start as a family business. Maybe the proprietor, maybe the brothers or the cousins started something. And then maybe in due course of time, some may have become corporatized. Your question is, can I give you an example of how an international failure takes place? There are many. And there are many reasons why a family business fails. It could be the infighting. It could be the owner or the person who started the business did not foresee and have someone who will take over from him. Or it could be that the owner has transferred the business to a child who is not suitable for the job. So there could be many examples. I'll give you one example, that there was a company called Carman, which started in 1901, and they actually made ways to make car bodies.
Car batteries.
They used to make car bodies. Mm. They made car bodies for Volkswagen, Mercedes, BMW, the world's top companies. They used to make car bodies. One of the famous car body names is called Carman Kia Volkswagen. Mr. Carman, who was a second generation, died in 1999. Within 10 years, the fighting started amongst his successors. No one knew what is to be done with the organization. Within 10 years, the company became bankrupt. A company which was in existence for 100 years, they made the finest of the finest product, but the owner did not foresee that what will happen when I die. And that's a classical example as to how family businesses topples over, because perhaps for the lack of foresight. Very strange, but the owner had the foresight to run the business, make it profitable, to all the 360 degrees, only to realize he or she did not think what will happen when I'm not there.
So there's no succession planning.
Absolutely right. There was no succession planning, and there are a lot of Indian examples and this issue also.
So let us come to the Indian example. You mentioned about the Ambanis. Dhirubhai Ambani set up an empire, and then once he passed off, he didn't have a succession plan. It fell on the two brothers. Now tell us in your own words, what happened between the two brothers and why it happened?
Very good question, because it's a classical problem of the owner, the entrepreneur, who created a giant. He was himself a petrol pump worker. From there, he became one of the finest and the biggest Indian entrepreneur. But he could not think about, or he could not plan, what will happen when I die. And Mr. Dhirubhai Ambani clearly knew that he has two sons, Mukesh and Atil, and there is a possibility they might fight, but he did not do anything about it. So when Dhirubhai Ambani died, the natural thing happened after 2 or 3 years. Things were going on reasonably okay. When, unfortunately, what we believe is the wives were started telling their husbands that, why don't you take care of the company yourself? And that's where Mukesh and Anil fighting started, which is in a public domain in most of the cases. In fact, how the infighting destroyed the value is for us to even very difficult to imagine. Both the brothers got about $45 billion each when the split took place. Today, Anil Bhai is perhaps worth $1 billion only, whereas Mukesh Bhai is worth $100 billion.
So what's this difference between, is it got to do with personality, it's got to do with their upbringing, teaching, what is it that two people grown up in the same milieu go so differently?
And this is a blunder. And this is a classic example, a case study perhaps, of how business blunders takes over. Anil Bhai, in my view, has done a blunder of getting into too many businesses, not concentrating onto one or two which he is able to run better. And whatever money he was making, he was investing in new businesses, so he wanted to show the world, I'm a great businessman. Second big blunder, he took debt from the banks without realizing that he may not be able to pay it on time. Number three, he was so much busy with many activities, including films and, of course, his running. I believe that he did not have adequate time to concentrate on and give guidance to his managers. So many things went wrong there, and that's a big lesson to learn, that how Mr. Anil Ambani destroyed value while his brother added value, singularly and single-handedly added value.
Now, most of the family companies in India have come through an era of political control. Now, I want you to explain to us, what do you think of the role of the government, especially coming from the license permit Raj, where they would support one company or bring down one company? How much of that has affected Indian corporates over the period of time?
I believe pre-1991, before the so-called liberalization era, the businesses and success thereof were very much dependent upon government goodwill and government gifts. Surely, Reliance is one of the such story. And now, currently, if I may say today, I don't think that a government relationship is important for a business success, because more and more, India as a country has become laissez-faire. Laissez-faire means the government leaves the companies to do their own business. So while in the pre-liberalization era, government's support and goodwill and being able to turn them towards you was important, that I don't feel is as much as what it used to be earlier.
Why don't you have your tea also while we talk?
Thank you.
Okay, let's talk about mergers and acquisitions now. In your book, you have called it a mug's game. You said it's overrated. Why do you say that?
An organization, a business, can grow in two ways. They can either grow themselves, like construct a factory, which is called a greenfield expansion, Alternatively, a business can grow by acquiring another organization, which could also be named as brownfield expansion. Many entrepreneurs have the vision of becoming very big, all-powerful, controlling the market. And the fastest way for doing that is to acquire another company. The mistake which is made in many times in their eagerness to become big and their eagerness to make it fast, there is a tendency to overpay. And that's the first mistake which businessmen do. Acquisitions overpaid.
Valuation of the
yes, the valuations are then done inappropriately and they go and make a large payment. The offset of that is that you have to do a large borrowing. And the moment you borrow a large amount of money, you get into a debt trap, which is another mistake, a huge mistake. So most mergers, most acquisitions do not work. Historical evidence shows 70% of M&As did not work. This is contrary to what we feel and we think, but the fact of the matter is most don't work. And therefore, that's a big blunder. And the learning therefore from that is an M&A should not be done in a huff. There are lots of lessons to be learned, and most M&A succeeds if there is a give approach than a take approach.
By both sides.
First, when an acquirer acquires an organization, the acquiring company feels that I must take a lot of things. I must take their money, I must take their cash balance, I must take their technology, I must take their people. But that doesn't work. If you acquire an organization, you must first think, what can I give that organization? The moment you think that I shall give and not take, an M&A starts succeeding. Goes without saying, when you start giving, you should also take. It cannot be one way. So this give and take approach makes an M&A succeed. Perhaps it is not the normal way we read in the books, but that's my experience of seeing why and how an M&A can actually succeed.
You have talked about the top man, the CEO, or the chairman, whoever is executive chairman, whoever, that they are often responsible for bringing a company down. Why is this so? Is it hubris? Is it lack of experience? What is the reason that many of these people bring the company down?
Many entrepreneurs make the big blunder of overestimating themselves. I have started the company. I know everything. I have 360 degrees capability. I know finance. I know marketing. I know manufacturing. I know technology. I know HR. Impossible. God has not given us every possible capability. Therefore, one mistake which the entrepreneurs do, that I know it all, I can think about everything, I don't need any advice. Number two, a big blunder which entrepreneurs do is the greed. The greed to become big, powerful overnight. And three, not taking sane advice. Sometimes, I'm sure entrepreneurs are speaking to hundreds and thousands of people. They're speaking to their bankers, their advisors, their auditors, their own people, their employees, their managers. But are they listening? Speaking is fine, but you need to listen. And if you listen, of course, some of it may not be good advice, but it is important for the entrepreneur to able to sift through what is good and what is bad, and then try to implement the good ones. The ones who have been able to do that have been successful, like, I believe, Mr. Ratan Tata. Very successful businessman, he has listened to many.
You also said that in your book that the boards should be more proactive. At times when they see something is wrong, they should throw out the CEO or the chairman, whoever it is responsible. Does that happen in India?
My advice, of course, I'm talking about blunders, and my advice to the boards are that if an organization is not doing well and the board feels that CEO could be a cause of concern, the CEO should be sacked. It has fortunately started happening in India. Just a few days back, Mr. Thapar, who was the chairman of CG Power, was Mr. Gautam Thapar, who was a chairperson of CG Power, which used to be Crompton Group Powers earlier, a huge name in the country, has been thrown out. It was unheard of earlier, but it has happened. Therefore, boards perhaps have started reading my book already.
That's probably true. There are many questions I want to ask, but I'll probably end with one which is perhaps relevant in the situation we are in. You've also talked about it, about sexual harassment by the top person in the company. In view of the Visakha guidelines by the Supreme Court, do you think it's a major issue in at least in the board level or at the CEO and other levels in India?
I think it is an issue. It's a hush hush issue in the corporate world. The ladies or the lady who suffers from harassment keeps quiet in the Indian environment because she feels that I shall not be supported. I may be actually blamed, and the system will throw me out and I shall not get a job. There is a problem. It is true that the government is trying to do a lot. There are sexual harassment guidelines to the organizations. There are committees being made. The sexual harassment guideline needs to be in the internet, in the site, a website of the listed companies. Lots are being done. But the most important is we as humans have to change our thinking. We must treat every individual as our equal. We must treat a woman as if he's a man. No special favor should be asked for, or no special intent needs to be shown. But it's all in the mind. Unless we, the managers, change, I'm not too sure how this issue of sexual harassment is going to end in the Indian context.
There, like I said, there are many more questions I would like to ask, but I'm afraid we have run out of time. Thank you, Mr. Banerjee.
Thank you, Arjun.
Managing Director of Capri Hands India Limited, for coming to our show, Bibliophile.
Thank you, Hardeep. Wonderful talking to you. God bless you.